بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Very warm welcome to you all. It is beautiful to see you inshallah ta'ala after my little break last week. I hope you enjoyed the lesson with Ustadh Muhammad Al-Bizri. I'm sure he gave a very informative, very inspiring lesson to you all. Muhammad, says Muhammad, is one of my students, and subhanAllah, I go way back with him, and he is really a gentleman, and alhamdulillah, very passionate about the deen, and lots of wisdom, lots of knowledge there that he can share with you. Inshallah, I'll be inviting him back, so that way we can share the rewards, keep you also. It's always important to have fresh blood. I know that inshallah ta'ala in about, I think a couple of weeks, not next week, maybe the week after, I have another sheikh that's coming to see you and to deliver a nice presentation with you then inshallah ta'ala. So from time to time, we'll break it up a little bit with some different speakers, some fresh blood, so it can keep you inshallah ta'ala inspired and motivated inshallah. There is an announcement here that there is a children's movie and popcorn night. That's for children between the ages of 5 and 13, whereby on the Tuesday the 31st of December, which is known as the New Year's Eve evening, there's going to be just some popcorn and movie, and then basically children will be picked up at DY Masjid the next morning at 8:30. Now that's happening at the Masjid DY out at 12 South Creek Road in DY. The cost is pretty much a gold coin donation. There'll be some craft activity, pizzas, ice cream, dinner, movie, popcorn, pancake, breakfast, prayers. And this is being facilitated by our brother Dale, and places are limited, so bookings are essential. This announcement actually reminds me of something, and that is, subhanAllah, it's very, very important when it comes to our children and when it comes to this Generation Y, that they are inspired, they are stimulated mentally, and that there needs to be something that activities that are regularly done when we're trying to instill Islamic values into our children. Islamic etiquettes, Islamic teachings, that we do it in a way that is appealing to them, okay? So this is a great initiative, and I think to complement this initiative, it's very, very important that the teachers in the community, that the sheikhs in the community are able to connect with children. And sometimes what we find is happening is that the sheikh or the teachers are sort of, it's like they're on one planet and the children are on another planet altogether, and they're not being able to make the connections. And so the gap between teachers and between the students is very wide. And we really need to look at ways in bringing that gap to basically becoming no longer a gap, but to becoming a solidified unit. So that does require that we understand the ways of the youth of this day and age, and what is it that is going to be appealing to them. Because I can tell you now that many, many Muslim children, I think they are Muslims purely because their parents have pretty much said to them, "You're Muslim." And that's really all they know. They go, "Yeah, I'm Muslim, but Islam is boring, and you know, Islam, there's no fun in it." And then they look around and they see a lot of, fun activities that their friends at school are enjoying, or that they see in the shopping centres and the communities. So living in the West is very, very challenging. Okay, this isn't so much so if you're living in an Islamic country, because they're not exposed to that or to a lot of that. And even still, there are the challenges there. So I think what I'm trying to say here is that we really need to always be changing our strategies around when we're dealing with the children, and making sure that they understand their identity as Muslims, and they don't have mixed feelings about their identity, about who they are. And that's what I'm coming to the realization in this community, that many children are caught up between maybe their, you know, that part of their identity is that they are Indonesians or Lebanese or Malaysians or whatever it is. But part of their identity there is that they are also Australian. And then part of their identity is that they are Muslims. And so they're just finding it hard to combine and to know, you know, really who they are. So it's very, very important that when you are considering teachers and lectures and courses for your children, that those courses and those tutors or those institutes are facilitating for the children in such a way whereby the children are actually saying, hey, Islam is cool. You know, Islam is a beautiful faith. I love the teachings. I love the teachers. I love the atmosphere. I love the feeling that I get. And I think that's always the challenge in trying to make it exciting. I know as a teacher myself, when I enter a classroom with students, I find it very, very challenging. And I've always got to find a story. I've got to like sort of, you know, go down to their level and talking to them. And that's really what works best. But if I was just to go in there and start just regurgitating Quran and Hadith, they just switch off very quickly. And basically, they need to know what's in it for me. You know, what's really in it for me? What am I going to get out of it? So I think you know, an initiative like this one is a good initiative, and we need to keep on following up with this kind of initiatives whereby we are speaking the language of the children, inshallah. So let's support these initiatives, and if any other initiatives that you think would work in the community, put up your hand always, speak to the organizers, speak to the facilitators, and help out, inshallah ta'ala. All right, so today, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to be giving a presentation that is entitled Islam and the Festive Season, given that we are in the time of the year whereby everybody's celebrating, whether it's Christmas or New Year's or just the end of year sort of holidays, and basically what is the Islamic stance regarding these festivities, inshallah ta'ala. So this is, there was a presentation that I delivered recently, so this is based on that presentation, inshallah ta'ala, and I hope you really benefit from it, inshallah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today's presentation, inshallah ta'ala, is entitled Islam and the Festive Season. During this time of the year, many people around the world are going to be celebrating in one way or another, and more specifically they are celebrating Christmas, or they will be celebrating New Year's. So what is the Islamic position regarding these two celebrations and other celebrations? Now, first of all, we have to understand that alhamdulillah, the greatest blessing, the greatest ni'mah that Allah can bestow upon a person is the blessing of Islam. Islam is the only faith, the only way of life that is acceptable by Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah makes this very clear in the Quran when He said, "Inna ad-deena 'inda Allahi al-Islam." The deen to Allah is Islam. وَمَن يَبْتَغِي غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَن يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ وَهُوَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. And whoever accepts a way other than Islam, then it will not be accepted from him, and he will be from amongst the losers in the hereafter. So alhamdulillah, Islam is the biggest bounty from Allah Azza wa Jal. Today there are almost 2 billion Muslims around the world. And Islam continues to be a fast growing religion. And Islam continues to be a religion and a way of life that many non-Muslims want to try and find fault in and try and demonize Islam or demonize Muslims. And we see this is very evident in the media. So it's very important that we try and preserve our identity as Muslims, that we preserve our identity and the identity of our children as Muslims. Now, in one statistic that I have come across, it stated that when a people migrate to another country, to a foreign country, the first generation of that people lose their language. They begin to not be able to perfect or to speak the tongue of, or the mother tongue of, that people who migrated. Then the second generation, they lose their culture. They no longer have an affiliation to that culture, and they take on the culture of the target country. The third generation, this finding revealed that many of them will end up losing their deen, will end up losing their faith. They could become a different faith, they could become atheist, they could become agnostic. So therefore, where is the problem? The problem is that being a Muslim is not just about mimicking what your parents did, but it's about engaging in the exercises that will help us maintain our identity as Muslims. Just like, for example, when we want to look after our bodies, we need to be on a balanced diet. We have to eat the right food, avoid wrong food. We have to exercise regularly. So we need to engage in different activities in a certain lifestyle to ensure that our physical bodies are healthy. Likewise, when it comes to our identity as Muslims, we need to ensure that we are engaging in activities that will increase our faith, that will preserve our faith, that will get us closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. Because we all know that in Islam, iman increases and iman decreases. Al-imanu yazidu bit-ta'a. That iman, your faith increases through obedience. The more you obey Allah, the more you pray, the more you fast, the more you read Quran, the more dhikr that you make, the more that you position yourself in a Muslim community around good Muslims, then you're going to have, inshallah, no problem in maintaining your identity as a Muslim. So, and the opposite is true. وَيَنْقُصُ بِالْمَعْصِيَةِ. That your iman decreases through sin. When you are engaging in sins, when you are engaging in the forbidden acts, prohibited acts, then your iman will decrease. So it's very important now, in saying that, to be always nurturing, watering, feeding our iman and our identities as Muslims. And part of that is the environment. So when it comes to preserving your identity as a Muslim, I want you to remember three things for yourself and for your children. The first one is the environment. The environment is very, very important to having, to maintaining a healthy Islamic way of life. By environment, there are a lot of factors that you need to think about. You need to think about what area you were living in. If you were living away from the Muslims, well, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in part of a hadith, he said the wolf devours the lone sheep. That when the wolf sees the sheep in a flock, then it's very hard for him to attack. But when he sees the sheep by himself, then he will attack. And that is the way of the shaitan. The shaitan will attack, will target you when you are away from the Muslim environment. You know, subhanAllah, if you think about when you are in the masjid, if you are in a house, the house of Allah, surrounded by Muslims, you have a sheikh, an imam, a lecturer in front of you talking about Islam, I don't believe that your mind will be really wandering far off in terms of committing sin, because you're in a very healthy environment. So it's about where you put yourself. An environment is very important. And in the story of the man who killed 99 people, and then he killed the 100th person, at the end of that hadith, what happened? He was advised to go to another country whereby there was a group of believers who were worshipping Allah, and to place himself amongst this community. Unfortunately, he didn't make it and he died, and I think all of you know the hadith. So environment plays a very big role. Environment could be the suburb. Environment means close to masjid, close to Islamic organization, whereby you can send your children to activities. Likewise, whereby you can actually yourself go to lessons and lectures. So these are some of the environmental factors that I'm talking about. I'm sure there are many others that you can think about. So this is the first one. The second factor that contributes towards the preservation of your identity as a Muslim are your influences. Are your influences. There's an Arabic proverb that says, "Tell me who your friends are, and I will tell you who you are." So if your friends are people who are drinking and, you know, taking illicit substances and flirtatious and all those sort of, you know, having those negative traits, those antisocial characteristics or traits, then most likely you're going to be influenced by them. So it's very important to be around the right people. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he gave an analogy. Which analogy did he give? The analogy of the perfume seller and the blacksmith. He said, if you spend time with a perfume seller, then at least he's going to give you some perfume, or you're going to buy some perfume from him. At the very least, you will walk out of his perfumery, you know, with a very beautiful scent. He said, if you spend time with a blacksmith, he will either burn your clothes, or you will walk out with a foul smell. So really, you are a product of your environment. You are a product of your influences. I know personally, growing up in a Western country myself, that I went to after hours Islamic classes. I had parents who were religious. I had family and friends that were predominantly Muslims. I went to Islamic camps. So I had a lot of people around me that were influencing me and shaping my identity. That's what you really need to think about. You need to have a plan. Don't wait until the problem arises and say, "Hello, salamu alaykum, Sheikh. My son, my daughter doesn't listen to me. You know, they are 13 years old, 14 years old, and they disrespect me, and they don't pray, and they don't fast, and they're starting to question Allah." And then you say to them, you know, have you been practicing? Or you start to ask the questions, and you find out there was no influences in the past, no environment, and now you're trying to change 13 years or 14 years or more of indoctrination. You're trying to solve it in a phone call? Are you serious? You know, it's going to take time. Anything that takes time to break down will take time to build. And that's what we have to remember, inshallah ta'ala. And that's why we need to really have long-term goals and plans and be ready to make sacrifices. You need to be ready to make sacrifices when it comes to your time, when it comes to your money. Okay? So you need to make those sacrifices, inshallah ta'ala, to ensure the preservation of the Islamic identity, which is very, very important. Now, Influences is the second factor. The third factor are experiences. The experiences that you expose yourself to. The experiences that you expose your children to. Okay? So, yes. For example, I know that recently in Sydney, they have opened up a Wet n Wild. I think it's one of those theme parks. You know, and I'm hearing about Muslims who are going along to this Wet n Wild. Now, Wet n Wild is a place where there are swimming pools, where there are, you know, these giant slides. Lots of fun. Don't get me wrong. I'm all for having fun. But halal fun. And I'm not going to be having fun at the expense of my identity or the identity of my children being compromised as Muslims. Because in these sort of theme parks or whatever you want to call them, there's going to be, you know, women in bikinis, women showing their awrah, men showing their awrah. There's going to be free mixing, okay? And so on and so forth. There's also music. So what are you expecting is going to happen? You expect your child is going to not take notice of these things? So again, the experiences that you are going to be putting your children through are going to be impacting positively or negatively the identity of your child or your identity as a Muslim. So when you come to get married, or even now that you're already married, if you haven't given this any thought, especially if you have children on the way, or you have young children, you really need to start to put a budget aside for your children and their learning and, you know, sending them to camps. And yes, some of these camps are costly. They're not cheap. But there are lots of expenses, whether it's the transportation, whether it's the campsite, whether it's the food, the drink, what have you. But you need to be prepared to have a budget, especially during the school holidays. School holidays send parents broke. You know, there's a lot of money that you have to out because you want to occupy your child's time. You can't just keep them in front of the Xbox and the PlayStation and the internet and, you know, Nintendo and whatever it is, you know, 24/7. You're oppressing your child. And a lot of these games have many subliminal messages. So let's start to have a plan. Let's start to really think forward about the environment, about the influences, and about the experiences that you want to expose yourself and your children to. What we have to understand, that when we entered Islam, or as Muslims, we don't pick and choose. Islam is not like a buffet. You know, you go to a buffet and you can pick and choose. I'll have this, I won't have this, and you're really picky, you know? That's fun at a buffet, but it doesn't work with Islam. Allah says, "Udkhulu fi silmi kaffa." He said, enter into Islam entirely. Islam means submission. Islam means surrender. Islam means obedience to Allah Azza wa Jal. I need to submit my will to the will of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. So we need to set our standards, yes. Don't compromise your standards as a Muslim. Don't compromise your belief for anybody. Be firm, but be respectful. Be firm, be respectful, be wise. Know how to deal with the non-Muslims that are around you in addressing them and into educating them. You know, for example, wallahi, last night I was at a reception and the owner of that reception is a non-Muslim. And he knew who I was and he came and he gave his greetings to me. He said, "I've seen you around." And he said to me, "I want to ask you a few questions." I go, "Go ahead." He said, "You know, you Muslims at this time of the year, you Muslims, you believe in Jesus. You love Jesus from what I understand." I said to him, "Yes, that's right. We love Jesus. Of course we do." He said, "So is it okay to say Merry Christmas? Because it's celebrating the birth of Christ." I said to him, "Not quite. I wasn't going to be apologetic. I wasn't going to compromise. I've got standards. I've got belief that I'm not going to compromise, but I'm going to maintain my respect towards this man? So I said to him, no, as Muslims, of course we love Jesus, of course we acknowledge him, but there is no evidence to suggest that he was born on the 25th of December. There is no documented evidence, not in the Bible, not through the words of the disciples, not through the words of Jesus, not through the words of Maryam, Mary, his mother, that he was born on the 25th. And then we entered into a conversation, but I was avoiding, you know, I didn't want to sit there and tell him, well, in Islam, you know, we have, you know, innovations, bid'ah, and we only have two Eids, Eid al-Fitr, Eid al-Adha. I wasn't going down that path, you know. At the moment, all that interested me was I need to relate to him that, hey, you need to be questioning. You need to be questioning this celebration. You're celebrating it, I'm not. And then we got into some nice conversation, and inshallah, maybe one day I'll dedicate a lecture to that. But so I made it very clear to him. And actually, since we're talking about the festive season, I've already just brought up the issue of Jesus and his birth. Yes, even when it comes to the birth of Jesus, and you see pictures, and you see, you know, these stands portraying Jesus' birth and his family, and, you know, and they make out that he was actually born in summer or winter. They make out that he was born in winter. If you think about now, we're in Australia. In Australia, it is now the summertime. But if you look at the northern hemisphere, what is it? It's winter. Okay, in the southern hemisphere, it's summer. In the northern, it's winter. And that's where they believe he was born, at this time of the year, which is actually winter for them. So they actually believe that he was born in the winter time. But when you look at the facts, when you look at, for example, when he was born, there are reports that the farmers during that time of the year were sleeping out between the greenery, the grass and what have you, because it was so hot. When he was born, what did Mary do? She shook the trunk of a palm tree, of a date palm tree, and what fell? Dates. Do dates fall in winter or in summer? In summer. So that's part of the evidence, but there is no documented evidence. No, you will not find evidence to suggest. And actually, when you read the books of encyclopedia, you will read that the 25th of December is a celebration that is based upon, that is built upon a pagan festivity. Pagan festival. Likewise with New Year's. New Year's Eve. There was, during pagan times, there was a god known as Janus, who had two faces, one facing forward, one facing backwards. And so they came up with, they said, January, or name it, was named after Janus being the first month of the year, looking forward and putting the year behind them. So again, another pagan festivity. They have no origin, not in Christianity whatsoever. So now, really, the Christians, really, what are they celebrating? They're not celebrating anything that has any basis, not in the Bible, okay, and not according to the disciples, and not according to Maryam, Mary. Now, every people want to have a celebration. Everyone wants to celebrate. And alhamdulillah, what's beautiful about Islam is we do have our celebrations. We do have our unique celebrations. On a weekly level, we have Friday. Every Friday is the weekend of the Muslims. Every Jummah. In the Muslim world, the weekend is actually Thursday and Friday. Countries like Saudi Arabia, Thursday and Friday are the 2 days off. So Friday is the day that the Muslims congregate. On a yearly level, the two celebrations are what? Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. Eid al-Fitr is the day after fasting Ramadan, coming as a reward for having fasted and gone through some sacrifices. And then Eid al-Adha is in commemoration of the story of sacrifice between Prophet Abraham and his son Ismail, and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ransomed his son with a sacrificial animal. So the only two celebrations we have are these two celebrations. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he made it very clear that there is to be no other celebrations. There is no basis for Mawlid. We as Muslims do not celebrate the birthday of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How do we celebrate our love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? We celebrate it by way of following his way, following his sunnah, following his tradition. In Islam, there is no celebration for Isra and Mi'raj. When the Prophet ﷺ went from Mecca to Jerusalem, he went from Jerusalem, he ascended through the seven heavens, up to the low tree, back down in one evening, as we read in Surah Al-Isra. We don't celebrate this. Muslims don't celebrate the migration between when the Prophet ﷺ, he migrated from Mecca to Medina, which was the turning point for Islam and for Muslims. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did migrate to Medina, he saw the people of Medina, the inhabitants, were celebrating 2 days. And he questioned them about these 2 days. And he said to them, "What are you celebrating?" And they said, "These are 2 days that we used to celebrate in Jahiliyyah, in the time of ignorance, in the times of ignorance, Jahiliyyah, the pre-Islamic era." So he said to them, Allah has substituted them both with Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. They're our two celebrations. And it's very, very important that we do make those 2 days days of festivity. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in one hadith, he said, when he spoke about the days of Eid, more specifically when he was talking about the Eid al-Adha, he said that they are days of eating, drinking, and the remembrance of Allah. Drinking, of course, in this context is drinking that which is allowable. So yes, we are to celebrate, and we are to congratulate one another, and to say, Taqabbal Allahu minna wa minkum, and Eid Mubarak. So we need to make sure that our children feel the buzz, that they feel the excitement. Do not allow Eid al-Fitr or Eid al-Adha to pass without having showered your children with gifts. Shower them with love and the people around you. Decorate your homes. Make them feel that it's a celebration. So when they do see the Christmas lights and the Christmas trees and all that comes with Christmas, they feel also that, hey, we've got better. We have something better. But the problem is, when they see Christmas and they see these celebrations and they see, you know, the gifts, and especially, for example, if your children go to public schools, they're going to feel, hey, why is Islam so boring? Islam isn't boring. It's the parents that have made it boring. With all due respect to the parents. But we really have to lift our game and make it exciting for our children. And especially in the last week or two of school, the last week of school, if your children go to a public school, I would personally recommend that you decrease the hours that they go during that last week. Because that last week, that's when they're going to be exposed to, you know, the Christmas party, the Christmas gifts, the writing of cards. So it's very, very important. If you cannot talk to the teacher about having your child removed from that environment, then at the very least you remove them from that environment, so they don't get confused, so they don't feel that, you know, that so it doesn't play with their identity as Muslims. So, alhamdulillah, these are the only two celebrations that we celebrate, and any celebration apart from this is deemed as an innovation, is deemed as a bid'ah. And Islam is against innovative practices, is against heresy and heretical belief and heretical actions. So alhamdulillah, we will find that the people of the book will always never be really pleased with us at the end of the day. So that's why I said earlier, don't be apologetic. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَن تَرْضَ عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَلَن نَصَارَ حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ. Never, وَلَن, لَن means never. وَلَن تَرْضَ عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ, the Jews and the Christians will never be pleased with you until you follow their ways. It's a battle between truth and falsehood. Yesterday I had a young lady give me a call, and she's a revert, and she's confused. And she said, my father has been looking into Islam. He's pretty much an atheist, but he's been looking into Islam, looking into Christianity. He's most likely going to become, at the moment, more of a Christian. And he's saying to me, and he's putting doubts in my mind and in my heart, and now I'm stuck. I don't know. I don't know what to believe. And then I started to question her. And when I found out about some of her questions, they were totally unfounded. For example, amongst many things that we spoke about, he said to her that, did you know that Islam is a pagan religion? Islam is a pagan religion. That you worship, Muslims worship the devil. And I started to give her verse after verse from the Quran, how Allah makes it very clear not to follow the shaitan. How the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke against paganism and tribalism and all the different types of isms, and how this was totally unfounded. So again, there's always going to be a campaign out there, people trying to brainwash others into thinking that Islam is backwards. But really, when you start to analyze the text, analyze the Sharia, analyze the Quran, analyze the Sunnah, you will find there is no system, no way of life, no religion that can come near to Islam. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So, alhamdulillah, this time of the year can be very challenging for many reverts, for many converts. They find it very challenging because, you know, they can't partake in these celebrations. So yes, when it comes to giving gifts as Muslims, we are not allowed to give gifts to non-Muslims in the name of Christmas or in the name of New Year's. We are allowed to give gifts in general. Are we allowed to accept gifts? Yes, the ulama have said we are allowed to accept their gifts. Ali radiallahu anhu wa arda, he once accepted a gift that was given in the name of a celebration, which was known as Nairuz, and he accepted that gift, as Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullahu ta'ala and others have stated. So yes, we are allowed to receive the gifts, but we are not allowed to initiate the gifts. We are not allowed to exchange greetings as Muslims, but instead say something very general. Say something that's very polite and respectful, but we don't need to be apologetic, and we don't need to be compromising our identities as Muslims. We do not support, we do not help when it comes to sin and when it comes to transgression. And so we need to, as Muslims, accept this reality. And reverts, converts in Islam, my advice to you is to accept that this is the way it is. And the quicker you accept, then the happier you'll be, inshallah ta'ala. But what I do say to reverts and to converts, it's very, very important that you communicate with your families about your belief and about your standards. Communicate what it is that you can do and you can't do. Don't try and fix the problem and deal with the problem at the time of Christmas, or at the time where they've invited you for dinner and you knock back the Christmas dinner or the New Year's Eve party. You need to sit down with your family members prior and discuss with them what it means to be a Muslim, how important Islam is to you, and how when you don't participate in these activities, that it's nothing personal, but that it's just an issue of values and an issue of standards and an issue of belief, and that you are happy to engage with them in any other general dinners and gatherings with the family. That's what you have to consider. Prevention is better than cure. Prevent the time of confusion happening by communicating with your family members what your new set of belief and new set of standards are. Very, very important to communicate as soon as you become a Muslim, or as soon as the dust has settled somewhat, to sit with your family and to talk to them. Okay? If you may want to use different strategies, and my advice to you is to speak to people who have been there already and that who have had difficult families, and how they dealt with their families who were struggling with their Islam. Not all non-Muslim families are hesitant to cooperate or to be accommodating, but some of them are very, very aggressive, and you just have to change your strategies with them and try different things out and test the waters with them, okay? Don't just dive into the deep end straight away, but test the waters, bring it on slowly. Have wisdom. Remember, wisdom is what? The usage of the appropriate words at the appropriate time, at the appropriate place. Show them respect. Islam, as we read in Surah Luqman, we read that even if your parents are non-Muslims, you are obligated. It is fard, it is wajib, it is compulsory for you to be respectful and obedient to your parents as long as they do not command you to do something which is haram. Don't compromise the law of Allah Azza wa Jal. Be respectful towards them. Be humble towards them. That is the command of Allah Azza wa Jal. The command of Allah is that you respect your parents, that you love your parents in the way they want to be loved, that you make sacrifices for your parents, irrespective of the belief that they have. But the only time you draw the line is when they command you to do something which is haram. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَا طَاعَةَ لِمَخْلُوقٍ فِي مَعْصِيَةِ الْخَالِقِ, that there is no obedience to the created by disobeying the Creator, by disobeying Allah Azza wa Jal. We need to remember this. So, accept that you have now a new set of belief, that you have a new way of life. Accept this. Be brave. Use different strategies. Get advice from other people. Make dua. It's going to be a long journey, probably. It's going to be a painful journey. But every success has a painful story. And every painful story has a successful ending. Wallahi, I know parents who were so aggressive against Islam, only to become Muslims 15 years later, 20 years later. It takes time. Results will take place when you allow the time and when you are putting in the hard work, when you are changing your strategies. It's not going to be a walk in the park. There are going to be strategies. Expect the unexpected. Be prepared to go through some short-term pain in order to avoid long-term pain. in order to achieve long-term gain. We need to do this, inshallah ta'ala. We owe it to ourselves to be prepared for trials and tribulations. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, those people that will be trialed the most are the prophets and the messengers and those who are following closely in their footsteps. Allah says, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّ وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Do people think they will be left alone just because they say we have believed and that they will not be trialed? You will be trialed. You will be tested. And everybody's test is different. Some people will be tested in their health. Some people will be tested with their wealth. Some people will be tested with their lives and the loss of lives around them. So everybody will endure in one way or another. Except, say Alhamdulillah. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to just make the situation easier. The situation might not become easier, but ask Allah to make you stronger. Ask Allah to make your skin thicker in dealing with these challenges. The challenges will always be there. That's just part of life. The only time they will cease to exist is when you pass on. The only time they will cease to exist is when you are in Jannah. And that's why, to a believer, this world is a prison. He is being imprisoned from Al-Jannah. To the non-Muslim, this is his Jannah. This is his paradise. And so we need to accept that we are like prisoners. And we will go through a lot of hardship, just as prisoners do. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with all of the resources that will preserve our Islamic identities, that will increase our iman, that will protect the identity and the iman of our children and their generations. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us a deeper understanding of Islam, not just a superficial understanding of Islam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us steadfast, especially living in the West, especially living amongst or in an environment where there is a campaign against Islam and the Muslims. These are the words I leave you with, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.